Keep us mindful always that you have given us a ministry to serve in this community. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So we're going to zip through in less than 50 minutes, maybe. Everything on the left-hand side, that's what we're talking about today. For those of you who were not here for the center column, it's on the website under adult education. You can see it and read it and learn it and inwardly digest it and make it a part of your heart and your mind so that the law of the Episcopal Church is written on your heart. You don't have to read that law. So we're going to talk about congregations today. And you will discover that Bishop William White, who was the author of the structure of our church, around the time of the founding of our nation, Bishop William White was a great fan of not only the way the United States government was organizing itself, but also of parallelisms. And so, if you see in the diocese at the center, in capital letters as bishop, in a congregation, see if this works. Back. We have a rector or a vicar. You all know the difference between a rector and a vicar. Well, let me enlighten you. The rector is the priest in charge of a congregation which is incorporated in the state of North Carolina as a separate corporate entity. And as such, the rector is the president, the chairman of the board, and the CEO. When a rector is hired never. A rector is called to ministry. And when a rector is called to ministry, that rector is called by a vestry. And the vestry's responsibility day one is to do everything in their power to support the ministry of that rector. Because it is in their best interest. Because day one, a rector has life tenure. You may not lower the salary of nor fire a rector. Now, I know rectors whose salaries have been lowered, but they agreed to it, either for economic reasons. During the Great Recession, some rectors took cut in pay in order to keep the parish solvent, you know, that kind of thing. But the rector has to agree to that. And while it is true that a rector has lifetime tenure, one-third every year of all the clergy who leave congregations leave so involuntarily. One-third. Okay. Why is that? Okay. Well, there are two reasons why that is, and usually they're both operative. One is because the rector's an idiot. Not working out, doing the wrong thing. The other is the vestry's an idiot. They made the wrong call. Why do vestries make wrong calls? Well, because they don't listen to the diocese and the bishop. One of the weaknesses of our system in the Episcopal Church is allowing congregations to have autonomy. When you were incorporated as a corporation in the state of North Carolina, you were made an autonomous corporation in union with the Diocese of East Carolina. Okay? A vicar is the head of a congregation that is not self-supported and therefore is not a corporation in East Carolina or in North Carolina, and therefore the bishop is the rector and the vicar is the bishop's representative on site. You get the difference? Okay, this is a very important distinction because there are actually people in this congregation who believe that you have the right to call whoever you want to be rector. You do not. Okay? There are two places that a bishop can intervene in a congregation and their relationship. relationship with their rector. The first time is at call. The bishop must approve the call of anyone who is elected rector. How does the bishop do that? You probably have been here or seen somewhere else a thing called the Celebration of a New Ministry. It's a book, it's a service in the prayer book. Okay? The bishop comes and says, this is your ministry and mine in this place. That's, those are words in the actual service. Okay? That's the way the bishop does that. Typically, a person is not instituted as rector right away. So there's a pre-part which says the bishop approves or disapproves of the call. I worked for a bishop who frequently did not approve the call of a rector. Why? Because the parish thought they could elect whoever they wanted. We are in union with the diocese, and the bishop gets a say. Every person who will be a candidate for rector in this place, every person will go pass by the bishop's desk. And probably, when you get to the finalists, we'll have to meet with the bishop or the bishop's representative. It was really weird, because when I left the parish, I became archdeacon and chief executive of the staff. And when they elected my successor, the bishop was out of town, and I had to meet with him and decide whether he was okay. Just so you get this clear in your mind, anybody know what the word rector means? It's from the Old English, and it means ruler. Rectors have extraordinary power in their congregation, just as bishops have extraordinary power in their diocese. Now, the good ones work in collaboration with the leadership of the congregation, and the bad ones, not so much. So it's a partnership. It's been frequently said that the relationship between a rector and a vestry is like a marriage. There's a courting period. There's heavy negotiations. There is a consummation. And then you got the rest of your life. And that's why one third of them don't work. We're doing better than Americans. Okay. So, when we think about St. Philip's, one of the things that we are right now is in a process that is guided by the bishop's direction. I'm here because the bishop said to the vestry, look at this guy and see if you want him because he's my guy. Okay, now you'll note, it doesn't say priest in charge. That's what I did, okay? By tradition, and not in canon law, a priest in charge has all of the powers of the rector, plus the imprimatur of the bishop. So on some level, the rector better be good at that answer to me. Okay? Now, we will be in partnership with the diocese when the bishop and the vestry together determine that it is time to have a search committee. This is how you get a rector. I know you've been through it recently, but so what? Let me tell you how it's supposed to go. Because it never goes how it's supposed to go. Okay? How it's supposed to go is the vestry appoints a search committee. Bishop appoints a consultant or somebody to meet with and work with the search committee to navigate the intricacies of the church deployment process, which is very complex, because every search in the Episcopal Church is a national search. That is to say, your next rector can come from anywhere, actually in the world. There are congregations that elect clergy from, well, Bishop Rock, elected in Michigan from Canada. Okay, now elected bishop here. So, first off, it's a very wide net that gets cast. Secondly, the search committee has a job. And its job is to articulate what is it we are looking for in the next person who will lead this congregation. What are the skills and talents that God will that God has given to certain people, and are those the ones that we want? Not everybody has the skill or talent to be the director of this place. How will you know that you've got a person with the skills or talents to run this place? It's called interviews. It's called a screening process. It's called a very particular way of helping the clergy to discern their own skills and to showcase them so that the search committee can say, yeah, that person has. And ideally, when the search committee gets down to the short list, which is usually two or three or four people, any one of those two or three or four people have the skills that are necessary to lead and be a successful rector in this place. That's ideal, okay? What makes the difference between candidate one, two, three, and four, all of whom have the skills to be a successful rector? Well, that's the part that everybody thinks is the first part. Do we have a fit? Is the person the right personality? You know, is the person credible to us? That's the second one. First, you gotta find, we have people, lots of people who you can like, but do they have the skills to do the job? So first, the skills to do the job, then we interview and we discern. Now that discernment is two parts. This is something I hope you will learn, because we're going to be working on this for the next while. And that is that no call is a legitimate call unless the church issues a call and the person responds positively to that call. It takes two to tango. So, Vestry says to person one, we discern that God is calling you to be our next rector. Person one then goes off and prays, talks with person one's family, friends, whoever they talk to, and they come up with an answer, yes or no. Has anybody ever turned one down? Yes, all the time. What then happens? Well, I can tell you that one thing that people have tried is they go to number two. Okay, but let me tell you, clergy talk to each other. And so if I'm number two, I already know who number one was. And I don't go anywhere where I'm number two. So that doesn't work. So what happens is you start again. How long does this take? According to Matthew Stockard, who's the canon to the bishop here in East Carolina, an average process is anywhere from 8 to 10 months. That's how that long it takes. If the person says no, you probably can shorten the next process by about 2 months. Why does it take so long? I'll tell you why it takes so long. You. You're all volunteers. If you were in a corporation, you'd come to work 9 to 5, and we could line you all up, we could get a lot of this done pretty quickly, and we could send you out on a business trip to interview everybody, you know, on a weekend or two, and we could do this thing more quickly. But a similar job as a college president, Episcopal clergy have a tenure of about 5 years on average across the country. That's considered an average tenure. Long tenure is anything over 10. College presidents have an average tenure of 3.5 years. Because they do it too quickly. This is serious business. One of the ways that congregations make mistakes is they rush the process. You have to take your time. Now, we should work with speed, all due diligence, yes. Okay? But that means that your search committee needs to be on call 24/7 and be ready to go because we're going to do it. And if we can get all that done, and then you have to hope that the people you're interviewing, whether that's by paper interview or by Skype interview or by in person, you have to hope that they are as efficient as you are at getting the job done. And because in the middle of any search comes Christmas, Easter, summer vacation, all sorts of things that slow the process down. Does this make sense to everyone? Okay. So, electing a director is serious business, and every due care should happen. When the search committee comes up with candidate one, they then give that to the vestry. Because only a vestry can call a rector. And if the person accepts it, then you've got the marriage, and then you negotiate and you do some other things. Questions? This is, I put this, you know, take it inside. Okay? Yes?
Are you saying there's not a required period of discernment in the mission?
A required period of discernment for what?
A period of discernment between the church and I?
Yes.
It is a required period.
Yes. And we are under that requirement.
It's a year. How long is the required period of discernment?
It depends on if you have a normal leaving. I'll call a normal leaving someone's been a rector for 7 years and it's taken a call somewhere else and everybody's happy and no one's stolen any money or run off with any organist or any of that stuff. then the search committee can be called relatively quickly because there are no issues in the congregation for leftovers on that rectorship. But there should be a little bit of space because you don't want the ghost of rector past to be present when the new one comes. If you have, I had one while I was there where a priest killed himself in church. Okay? Yeah, the discernment period is going to be a little longer in that case. Okay? If the rector was ran off of the ordinance, the discernment period is going to be a little longer. If the rector was involuntarily terminated, the period is going to be a little longer. That period is up to the bishop. In other words, think of the bishop as the person in charge of the starting meeting. Now, why do we do that? Well, we do it because that's our polity. That's the way we do it. But the second reason we do it is because a diocese has wisdom that a congregation doesn't have. A diocese has got 83 parishes in Southern Ohio. Well, we've been through that a lot, you know. If the rector's been there more than 20 years, that period of discernment is at least 2 years. Because the ghost of rector past is harder to get. So, there's no quick answer to that. It depends.
As a canon, how do you fit in with rector or vicar?
I'm priest in charge. Canon is my honorific title that you put on an envelope. Okay? My title here is priest in charge. And I'm kind of like a rector with diocesan tentacles.
When the search committee chooses a candidate, yeah, one, and makes a recommendation to the vestry, yeah, does the vestry have to accept that?
No. The vestry is the total free agent. And that's happened too. You know? Yes, sir.
Jim, are there occasions when the search committee might bring more than one name?
Yes.
To the vestry?
Yes.
I know what happened to someone I
someone you
respect
know
very well. It happened to him. In the church, we were looking for a rector, and he was one of the three.
Two. There were two.
Two candidates.
Yeah. Guess what? The other guy got it. The answer is that's a contract that the vestry makes with the search committee. If you want to move the process along, the vestry trusts the search committee to recommend one name, because then the vestry needs to interview that person. If the vestry says, and I've been working with them that said 3 to 5 people, and the search committee recommends 5 people, now you've got 5 weekends of interviews, and you're just taking another month to get the job. You understand?
I'm a search committee. They are people from the congregation, they are not vestry.
Entirely. Well, there's probably one or two vestry members to act as liaison linkage. So the vestry is informed along the way what's going on. But predominantly they're from the congregation.
Every once in a while, in very small places, the search committee is the best one because they don't have more people. Yeah. It varies. It all depends. Places like this, I would expect that there'd be more non-vestry than vestry on the search committee. But that will depend on what the vestry sets up. I'm not in charge of what the vestry sets up. That will depend on what the advice is from the consultant. I'm not in charge of the advice from the consultant. I'm giving you just kind of in general what happens. Okay? All right. Can we move on?
We did it right, didn't we?
There are three types of congregation in East Carolina. One is a parish in union with the diocese. Two is a mission, a congregation not yet admitted to the convention. And three are other ministries, such as campus ministry, which is considered a congregation. The farm workers congregation is considered a congregation, but it's not a parish. It's not incorporated that way. So they're specialized ministries. In other dioceses, other dioceses have different ways of doing this. Some dioceses have all congregations and they're all called congregations. Some dioceses call missions. Some call, and then new ones they call founding fellowships. That's just all nomenclature, but by and large here in this diocese, that's the way it works. Okay? All right. So, the corporation meets once a year called at a thing called the annual meeting. We just had one in December. Okay? At which you do various and sundry things. Always. See that little line going across the diocesan convention? You elect delegates to diocesan convention. Always, you elect members of the vestry or replace members of the vestry that are rotating off. And then you do other such business as properly comes before the corporation, plus reports. You know, how did it go last year? Are we solvent? Things like that. Okay? But, like a diocese, an annual meeting is a terrible way to run a year-round corporation. So you need something that is the corporation when the corporation is not needed. And that is called a vestry. Now, at St. Philip's, the vestry is comprised of 12 individuals elected for 3-year terms. So that means that four people each year should appear at the end, at least four people should appear at the annual meeting for election. You cannot succeed yourself. You have to wait out a year and then come back. Now, I'm going to break a rule that I have, which is try not to inject my opinion into things. This is my opinion with which you may disagree, but the stupidest thing America has done in the 20th century is term limits. Because what we did is we took all the people who were there forever and knew how the thing worked and put a whole lot of new people in who didn't know how the thing worked, taking all the power and giving it to the civil servants who were not going to move no matter who was elected, and now the power is down a level. It takes a vestry person. How many of you serve on a vestry? Okay, you know. How long before you know exactly what you're doing as a vestry person?
3 years.
3 years. And then you're gone. Actually, the third year is usually pretty useful. Okay? But that's our bylaws. That's the way it's done in this diocese. That is an opinion. I'm through with my opinion. Back to the facts. Okay? And the fact is that the vestry serves for a 3-year period, you're off for a year, and then you come back on. If you are so nominated by the nominating committee that nominates you. If there is a vacancy on the vestry, that vacancy will be filled by the vestry until the next annual meeting. And if there's still time left on that term, then that's another person that needs to get nominated. Okay, so that's why it's at least four that are coming to the annual meeting. What is the vestry? Well, one way of thinking about this is that the rector, who is the ruler, who is the king cock, sits wherever she wants, okay, is in charge of the spiritual life of the congregation,
which is why we exist, right?
And is also in charge of the building.
Most people don't know that part.
Okay. The vestry's job is to be in charge of the temporal life of the congregation, which includes raising all the money and taking care of the building. So what's the difference between the rector being in charge of the building and the vestry being in charge of taking care of the building? The rector gets to say who can use it. This is not a problem so far in Southport that I've uncovered. But I'll tell you what, it was a huge problem during the Civil Rights Movement. It was a huge problem during the Vietnam War. It was a huge problem. I got called by the FBI. There's a guy in my parish who's an FBI person. He said, don't you like to call, you've been reported to the FBI of harboring a communist cell. Wow, that's really cool. How did I do that? Well, it turns out that people who wanted to, it was during the Contra and the Nicaragua thing, a group of people who were very sympathetic to the more liberal side of that affair. And they were meeting to study what was going on in Central America. They were called the Central American Study Group. And all the people who were against it thought that that was a communist cell and that I let them use the building. So one of the things I did was I formed a group called the Sandinistas. And I said, you both can meet. And they used to have rival meetings. I mean, at the same time, across the hall from each other. And the first couple of times, I got people monitoring this to make sure they didn't cross the DMZ. But who uses the building can be a real big issue, depending upon which country. Okay, any questions about vestry? Okay, every vestry has wardens. Now, every diocese does that differently. Most dioceses, unlike East Carolina, most dioceses have 14 people on the vestry, 12 vestry persons, and 2 wardens. And the wardens are elected separately. Some dioceses, like the Diocese of Pennsylvania, doesn't have a senior warden and a junior warden. It has a rector's warden and a people's warden. And the rector gets to announce who the senior warden is, and the vestry gets to announce who the junior warden is. And in some parishes in the Diocese of Pennsylvania, those are 2 extra people. In some parishes, those are 2 people from the 12 that are already there. That's the last one, from the 2 people that are already there, is how we do it. Our senior warden and junior warden come from the elected body. The rector gets to say who the senior warden is. The vestry gets to say who the junior warden is. Why is that important? It's important because in corporate law, the junior warden and the senior warden and the treasurer and the secretary. Now, in this parish, neither the treasurer nor the secretary is an elected member of the vestry. Okay? Those 4 people are the corporate officers. So, when this has happened just recently, I chair, because I have the power of the corporate CEO president thing, I chair the vestry meetings because I'm the chair of the corporation, okay? Ruth and Jimbo were basking in the sun. And we had a vestry meeting, and I happened to have to be away as well. So Bill Bittenbender, who's the junior warden, was the person who chaired the meeting. A number of people said to me, well, why didn't Reggie chair the meeting? Who can answer that question? Bill, you can't answer.
He's not an officer. He's not.
He's not an officer of the corporation.
He works for you.
Right. He is a staff member of the congregation. Could he do a good job? Yeah. And when he was here, before I got here,
He was acting as a pro tem officer of the corporation, so he chaired the best meetings. That was all proper. So we actually do follow these laws, which may come as a surprise to many of you. Questions? Come on, you can do it. Some parishes have what are called trustees. Now, trustees are interesting. Trustees are a body elected by the annual meeting, typically, or sometimes appointed by the vestry. And their function is to take care of all of the restricted endowments that a congregation may have. Okay? Some parishes have no endowment whatsoever, so therefore they don't have trustees. Other people say, well, the vestry can be the trustee. Other parishes have a little bit of endowment, well, the vestry can be the trustees, and that happens in places. Parish I left had $21 million. They had trustees. Okay? And having a set of trustees is a really interesting thing, because in the Episcopal Church, money is power. And if you're a trustee and you decide to withhold the funds, that can be a real problem. Or if you decide you're going to use it, well, I'll give you an example. There's a congregation in Ohio. The income from the endowments annually is about $6 million. The income from the pledges is about $230,000. So the vestry creates a budget for $230,000. And the trustees created by the about $6 million. Who do you think's got the power? Who's really acting as the vestry? Yeah. And they finally unwound that now by saying that that because the name funds were for a purpose, and they passed some laws around that the trustees had to get the money for the purpose for which it was given, and it was given to the vestry. Now the vestry has a very big endowment income line in their $200,000 budget. But they, now the vestry makes that choice. That took, really seriously, I'm not kidding you, only 212 years to get right. It's a long time, okay? So when this parish receives the $4 or $5 million endowment that's coming, I'm not announcing anything, I'm just putting an idea in here. Picking trustees and getting them right is important. There's a great line about the priest who announces that they're going to do a capital campaign. And he says it's going to be a $2.5 million capital campaign. And the good news is we've got the money. The bad news is it's in your pocket. Stay tuned. So that's what trustees do. Okay. Yes?
Who appoints the trustees?
Depends. Sometimes the congregation I served, the vestry set up a fund that was going to be the permanent property fund to endow the building, and it set up all the rules and it set themselves up as the appointers of the trustees. Then they received $16 million request, and the requester asked for trustees and said that should be elected at the annual meeting. So usually when you get a request and restrict after $16 million, you obey the wish of the donor. And so that's a congregation that actually has two different sets of trustees appointed by two different ways. Okay? Yeah. Yes. We have trustees of the mission. What's that called?
Mission Fund has still got, but they have a committee that's basically in charge.
They have a committee that in the document that conveyed that money to the Mission Fund, it called for a committee, and that committee makes recommendations on the use of that spending, on the spending of that.
Any other endowments we have are?
Most of the other endowments are unrestricted, and therefore they don't have trustees. Current. Right. Yeah. You know, the thing you don't want to do is proliferate trustees. That's like the worst thing in the world. I mean, trustees are hard enough. I was one for 18 years. They're hard enough to be. But so what you typically do is say, for large endowments, we'll follow the wishes of the donor, or we'll get the donor to agree that, that the current trustees are also taking care of that. When we're talking about monies that are less than $1 million, or even less than $500,000, or even less than $100,000, you don't want to keep proliferating trustees. That would just be a nightmare. So it's part of it is organizational sense. People get it. Yes.
Okie doke. Okay, the next thing we get is the staff. Now, this is an important thing, and how many of you have ever served on a not-for-profit board? Okay. Thank you for your service. When not-for-profits run into trouble, it's when the board thinks that it's in charge of the operation of the program. The board is not there for the operation of the program. This is also true in churches. The vestry is not the boss of either the rector or the rector's staff. That's that whole staff thing is operations, and that's taken care of by the people in the office. And everybody works at and for the rector and at the rector's pleasure. Period. Where congregations run into trouble is where individuals think that they can tell the staff what to do. Please, if you have a request for the staff, you know, and we're not filling out requests and forms and doing that, but come talk to me. I'm happy to deploy the staff if it makes sense, or argue with you if it doesn't. Okay? But just imagine if you're a staff member in this place. We have a sexton who is not here most of the time, that you're here. But if you ever run into that sexton, I can imagine what would it be like for her if you all of a sudden you had a project that you wanted her to do. You know, she slid a wrist, rightly so. Or swing a mop at you, even worse. Okay, so let the people who are in charge of doing that work do that work. That's a very important piece of thing to say. Any rector and any rector's staff is here to serve the needs of the congregation. So we sure care what you think. This is not shut up and go away. This is, I'll be the point person. Fair enough? Cool. Questions? Yeah. No. And as a matter of fact, the human resources person can go use the record. In other words, that's both the strength and the weakness of the system. Okay, if you have a staff, I had, you know, in Cincinnati, I had a staff of 31 people, and I was the HR person for all 31 people, managed their benefits, did all their stuff. Did they all love me? Mostly, but not all. Did I sometimes deploy other staff members to talk to them and see who could resolve their issues? Yes. You use the resources that you got. You know. But bottom line, if it's irreconcilable, as my secretary used to do to me, as I left the office, she went. Every staff person at St. Philip's either has or will shortly have a job description, a letter of agreement, and a list of roles and responsibilities. And annually, they will be reviewed. Now, it's at this point I want to talk about what I think is the most important issue facing St. Philip's today. And that issue is trust. Somebody asked me the other day when I said this, well, how can we trust? And I said, start with trust. Don't start don't let your default be mistrust. And if you have a reason to be offended, and because the trust was given and not dealt with faithfully, then let's deal with that issue. The second way you build trust is called accountable ministry. Okay, if I ask you to wash the windows, and you agree to do that, and you're called to the ministry of washing windows, and you say, I say, when do you get them done? And you say, I get it done by the weekend, and whatever, then you gotta come back and say, I did the windows. In other words, it's a loop from agreement to completion. And if every ministry in this place is accountable to somebody or some body, then that helps build trust. So what do we do? What do we do to vestries? Let me tell you, this is what we do to vestries. A lot of you serve on vestries. Tell me if this ever rings true. We say, the vestry says, we need to pave the parking lot. So we get the junior warden, who's the chairman of Building and Grounds, and we say, get some estimates, and we got $35,000 to pave the parking lot, get it paved. Okay, so the junior warden, who works outside of the home for pay during the day, has to either take time off or schedule some really weird time to meet with three people to get estimates. And that takes a couple of months. After 3 months, the junior warden comes back to the vestry and said, here's the three estimates. This one's going to do that. This one's going to do that. This one's going to do that. I say we go with this one because A, B, C, D, E. The next sentence is insidious, and it happens every time. Somebody raised their hand and said, have you talked with Bob? He just had his driveway done. Maybe you can talk to that person. If we give the junior warden the job of doing it, and it's going to be done within budget, and he's followed the path that we've said, get three estimates, and here's the one they recommend, you don't have to say anything. And if you start behaving that way, then trust starts to happen. Now, part two. How else does trust happen? When the junior warden fails at the assignment. He says, we go with B. We do B. And the person does a terrible job. Some bright bulb in the vestry stands up and says, why did you go with that guy when I told you to go to Bob's and talk to his guy? Okay? If we are not a community of people where it's free to fail, where we learn from our failures, where we nurture one another when things don't work, then why are we here? On a very basic level, everybody who accepts a ministry has to know that if they fail, we stand with you and we'll learn from it. That's all you need to know. But what we won't do is hack you up on a cross, because that's already been done and you don't have to do that anymore. Are we making any sense here? Okay. Those two things, freedom to fail and accountability, those two things, in fact, will build trust really quickly in an organization. And that's what needs to happen. All right. I'm going to actually get this thing done. And then there are ministries. Now, a word about ministry. How do we know that there's a ministry? Okay, I already gave the answer to this one, so somebody raise their hand and tell me how you know there's a ministry. Yes?
If I decide I'd like to do something, I would come to the vestry and say, hey, vestry, I want to organize a tiddlywinks contest. May I?
Yeah. She said, well, if she decides to do something, she goes to the vestry and says to the vestry, I'd like to organize a tiddlywinks contest. May I? And the vestry says yes, then we got a ministry. But you don't just have to come to the vestry. You can come to the priest in charge.
Oh, good.
You can come to the assistant rector. You can come to the administrator. You can come to the junior warden. You can come to the senior warden. Depends on what level it is. If you had an idea, say, I have an idea. I'd like to start a ministry, but it's going to cost $40,000 a year. Better go to the vestry for that. Okay? If you want to have a tiddlywinks contest, then maybe it's a matter of scheduling, you know, or whatever. And so you do that. But both things have to happen. The person has to feel called, and the person has to be called. Now, please, for as long as I'm here, there are two words I don't ever want to hear. Recruit and volunteer. None of you are volunteers. You are ministers of the gospel, ordained in your baptism and confirmation to do ministry on behalf of the church. Each and every one of you is that. And a good church is busy about the task of helping people to discover the ministry that God has in mind for them, and helping them to grow spiritually in that process. Okay? A bad church is one that doesn't have ministries, they recruit volunteers. And the primal example of that, it changes the whole way this happens. You call it something else here, like the fall bazaar. It's the rummage sale. Okay? The, if you're a clergy male, dreaded rummage sale. At which I can remember that every head of the rummage sale in the 10 years prior to my coming to the church in Cincinnati quit the parish at the end of the rummage sale. So I had an idea. I felt called by God to eliminate the rummage sale. And I said to the vestry, I feel called by God to the ministry of eliminating the rummage sale. And the vestry said, go for it. And then they all backed away and said, you talk to We are ministers, and we're in the business of calling people to ministry. That's what we do. And it's okay to use our language. You know? The ministers of this congregation, and I will tell you that after Easter, we're going to begin a whole other series of stuff that's going to be about ministry. And how ministry works in congregations, and how that can work in an accountable system, and how it can work in this parish of this size. Okay? That's the vestry's going through that this week. Just to give you some idea, by the way, has anybody ever had this experience? Hi, I'm Jim, and I'm calling to recruit you because we need a volunteer to take notes at this one meeting. And it won't be a lot of work. It'll only take an hour, and then you'll be done. And then you find out you signed up for 4 years of forced labor with sledgehammers. And that ever happened to anybody? When you go to this, hi, I'm Jim, and I believe God is calling you to the ministry of taking notes. Here's what it requires. It's going to require one meeting a month, and probably another 3 or 4 hours to go over the things that you took as notes at the meeting and then get it out. And we're asking you to do this for a period of 3 years. And if that's something you think God is calling you to, please let us know. Do not give me an answer now. I'll give you 3 days, and at the end of 3 days, give me a call, and if you feel God is calling you to this ministry, please do it. And please understand, if you say no, I will say hallelujah. Not because I want you to say no, I still think God's calling you to this. Okay? But do you know what we do? The place we do this the most is with church school teachers. People who don't want to teach church school, but they love Jesus, and they love their rector, and they want their church school to go, and so they involuntarily do this thing because someone's got to do it. And what happens? What happens is we make little Methodists. God has called them to, don't have a church school. You do less damage. This is pretty radical stuff. But so when I say ministries, I mean the ministries that emanate from the congregation. But there's another part. And the other part is the ministries that emanate from you. Because it's a two-way street, right? Okay? And that's the one that the Episcopal Church is horrible with. We don't do real well at that. Second. Okay, I'm finished, but I want to make sure and you have no questions about this. Does anybody have any questions?
Yes. I want to go back to Preaching Charge.
Yes.
In this diocese, you're saying that Preaching Charge is more than just rent a priest, he actually has the full duties and responsibilities of the rector of the chosen priest.
Absolutely. Well, and I want to say that, so far as I know, at least during Bishop Skirvin's time, I'm the only priest in charge he's ever made. He's done interim ministers, that's a different thing. He's done other kinds of supply priests, that's a different kind of thing. The hired young person, he's done that. As far as I know, and they spent a fair amount of time, I guess, trying to decide what my title would be. And they said, well, what do you want to be called? I said, Ramona. Take charge of as a priest in charge. I don't know. And by the way, that's true with Rob Skirving and me. It may not be true in another congregation. He may do something different in another congregation. And who knows what North Carolina is or Western North Carolina. It's different everywhere. Even within a state, it's different. Other questions?
So how are we doing? And how are you doing?
Well, I can answer the second question easily. How I'm doing is I'm having a very good time trying to figure you all out. I said to my wife the other day, I think I've got about 75%. I think I have in my back pocket about 75% of what the congregation needs. And I think that so far, you're all responding to that pretty well. Okay? There's another 25% that is the reason that I took the job, and that's to grow myself. Some stuff I'm learning and you're teaching me as well. How are you doing? Well, it depends. If I listen to the rumor mills, you're not doing well. If I listen to what people say to me, what the vestry said to me, and the vestry started to do some new behaviors that I'm really pleased with. Okay, I think we're making progress. Okay, I don't think we're going to solve and become the perfect parish in my time here. I don't think that we're going to fix everything. There's no such thing as a perfect parish to start with. But what the two things I think are here, and they're the things that give me hope, are number one, you're a really good congregation. Really are. And there's a joy in this place that's here that is a strength of this place. And I'm grateful for it. The other thing is, so far you've been willing to let me say some pretty outrageous things and I still don't have tars and feathers on. I said the first Sunday I was here that I'm going to say things that are going to tick people off and I'm sorry in advance. Be as strong as I can to do what I know how to do, and I will learn in the process. But the one thing I want you to know is this. I don't know how this is going to come out. I did not come with a playbook. I came with some tools. I did not come with how it's going to end up, and if I can just herd you on the right road, you'll make it happen. That is going to be your work. And so far, I've found a whole lot of people willing to accept that. That's good news. Yes?
It raises one question. It sounds to me like you came because there was this very identifiable and embraceable, understandable problem.
No.
Then what is it that you're trying to help us fix?
Okay, I came because after working with the vestry, the canon to the bishop and the bishop identified a number of problems. not a big identifiable one. And there are a number of them. And well, you want to know what they are?
They are.
They are.
Just so I can understand.
Okay. They are, number one, you had an involuntary termination of a record. That's a problem. Okay. Number two, your structure, the way you are organized and to behave as a congregation, fits the size of a congregation whose average Sunday attendance is under 75. You're pushing 300 some Sundays. So you're not organized and structured in a way that efficiently could run a congregation, which parenthetically may have had something to do with the previous dysfunction. Number three, there are not identifiable, there is not identifiably held common view of what the ministry of St. Philip's is. If we all agree the ministry of St. Philip's is A, B, C, D, and E, easy to find a rector, easy to run a staff, easy to get everybody marching the same thing. We don't. You are all over the map. So part of it is, can we develop a general consensus at which direction is forward? That's an issue. Number four, the relationship between the congregation and the vestry needs to be paying attention to. And that's both the vestry getting its own act together and the congregation being willing to and accepting the leadership of the vestry. Those are the four things that they identify. Yes,
ma'am. I need you, sir, to make the transition for meeting everybody in the same boat. When you are dealing with people who have different ideas about right and wrong outside of the church, is what really takes a lot of people out. Some people outside the church would not take being. Okay, so we are fighting a lot of personal held convictions that there is a track to run on in this track.
Yep.
And then there's another track that we're running.
Right. Well, part of it is education. Part of it's doing exactly what we're doing here. Why I'm doing these things every Sunday is because I'm going to try and at least point to a way forward that people can solve. Another commonly held way, it's the American way, is to have a common enemy. I'm not volunteering for that job. but I want to say that that's some ways people do that is you can make a unity by having a common enemy. I don't want to go that way. Another way is empowering people within the realms of our power, within the realms of the way we do things. So empower the vestry to be the vestry, empower lay leaders to be lay leaders, empower ministers to be ministers, empower the staff to be the staff, empower the clergy to be the clergy, and accept and trust that everybody's working on roughly the same page. A piece of that is coming up, and you'll hear more about this in the coming week, is we're working on creating a strategic planning group which will present to the congregation as a whole, after the vestry decides to own it or not, a plan that says for the next 3 to 5 years, here's our major work. And then they'll be about the job of enrollment. That means rolling it out so that people buy it, answer questions. You don't have to love it, you just have to not fight it. You know? Will we get 100%? No. But we'll get 95%
if we do. This is something you said just a moment ago, question, which was as part of the search process, or preceding the search process, we were making some period of introspection. Who are we, what do we want, what do we expect to go, and all that. Is that in the vision for, you know, in the future? Apologize to those that are new, maybe that already happened.
Well, number one, there wasn't a search so long ago, so the state of it. There have been three attempts that I've got data from since 2000 and a long-range plan. We've got data there. The strategic planning group is going to generate some more data, more contemporary data, and we're going to have data there. What the vestry is doing in terms of structure is, and new structure is going to require some learning, and from that learning will be some more data there. What we're doing in terms of strategic plan will provide data in and of itself. Okay? So, yes, I mean, here is the image that I use. You got four things, I'm supposed to fix four things, and where we are now is kind of like this. Okay? Where I want to go is like this. And they should fold into one another. If we're good, and if the timing's right and we do it right, it'll fold into each other. And hopefully we'll all be on roughly the same page. Yes, sir?
I can do it.
I'm honored to do it. Yes. I would say that in every diocese, when that happens, that's the work of the diocese to find somebody to come do that. Well, I'm just saying, the competence level of the people doing that vary as much as the competence level of any other. Hopefully, when I'm done, we'll say, yeah, that's my work. That may be good. Anything else? Yes. I got my doctorate in church structure. I was a canon to the ordinary of the diocese for 8 years in the Anglican congregation, so I've done this before in the congregations. And my experience in my parish, I was in the same parish for 22 years. The day I got there, my first Sunday, big crowd, 63 people. Budget, $77,000, with a $60,000 deficit. Is there any good you make that up? When I left, average Sunday attendance 500, budget 1.7 million. Okay? It took 22 years, I mean, this is not, like that. But what happened was, I learned that as congregations grow, the style of leadership needs to change. And there are a lot of people, I didn't go all in one place, but there are a lot of people who have that experience. So I think that's, those, I don't know, is, he, is am I saying pretty much what he said? Okay, it's 15 minutes to kick off with the next service then, next week, diocese.